Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this learning objective video, we will be discussing the muscles of the rotator cuff, as well as its close neighbor, the teres major muscle. So a bit more detail regarding what we will be discussing and expect you to understand upon review of this learning objective. So let's get right into it. So I do hope when you think of the rotator cuff, you think of the shoulder region. And so it makes sense that these muscles will have attachments on the major bones of the shoulder region. So proximally, they will all attach to the scapula. And they will literally be sitting on the body of the scapula with the majority of them. So 3 out of 4 are sitting on the posterior portions of the scapula. And you can see that here. So this includes the supraspinatus, the infraspinatus on either side of the scapular spine, and the teres minor. So you can see the teres minor right here. And there's only going to be one of the 4 muscles that will be more anteriorly placed on the scapula, and this is the subscapularis. You can see a little bit of it here deep to the biceps brachii tendon. All of these posteriorly placed rotator cuff muscles will have a distal attachment on the greater tubercle. So you can see it here osteologically. And that one anterior, more anteriorly placed rotator cuff muscle, the subscapularis, will have its distal attachment on the lesser tubercle, which is going to be right about here-ish on that image. And you can see it clearly here. The lesser tubercle is going to be more anteriorly placed. The greater tubercle will be more laterally placed. So it makes sense now why the greater tubercle is bigger than the lesser. It is going to have 3 muscles attaching there, whereas the lesser tubercle only has 1. As we discussed in the shoulder joint learning objective, the rotator cuff is hugely important in providing stability to the glenohumeral joint by forming that musculotendinous ring around the joint with that little bit of an inferior deficiency. I do want to note of clinical importance, and will be discussed in more detail in the upcoming shoulder clinical lecture, that the most frequently injured or damaged rotator cuff muscle is the supraspinatus muscle. So this is going to come up over and over again. And this has much to do with the location of its tendon between the coracoacromial arch, so over here in this region, and being between that arch and the actual joint itself. So if you imagine, it can be really impinged, that tendon can be really impinged during repetitive movements of the shoulder, in particular things like full flexion or full abduction. If I were making this illustration, I would have this kind of more white, this area more white to indicate the tendon of the supraspinatus muscle, so less like the muscle belly. But you get what we're talking about here. It's going to kind of travel through this region in order to go attach on the greater tubercle. Okay. 3 of the 4 rotator cuff muscles play a role in rotation of the joint, so both medial and lateral, depending on which muscle of the shoulder joint. I'm less concerned right now with you remembering which one does what, but I do hope you take away that these muscles play a role in rotation of the shoulder joint. Now, the supraspinatus does not. It is going to play a role in initiating the first 15 degrees of abduction, so kind of moving the arm away from the body before the deltoid muscle takes over. So supraspinatus is going to initiate abduction. All right, let's spend our last few minutes discussing the teres major, which, while not a rotator cuff muscle, is very closely located to these posterior rotator cuff muscles. So it's going to be located just inferior here to the teres minor. And it's a pretty big muscle, so we shouldn't ignore it anyway. I don't think this image does it justice. So the distal attachment will be on the humerus, but not directly on those tubercles that we just discussed. It's going to be a little bit inferior to those. But with this type of attachment, you know it's crossing the glenohumeral joint, so it'll affect the actions of the shoulder joint. As mentioned before, Teres Major is robust. Again, this illustration, I think, is not doing it justice, but you will see how large it is in the laboratories. It can be visible and palpated, particularly when contracting the teres major on the inferior lateral portion of the posterior axilla. So if you're looking kind of in the armpit region, you likely can see some of the teres major that's going to be deep to the skin. The teres major and teres minor muscles will form part of the boundaries for a space in this general region referred to as the quadrangular space. And this space is important in understanding where the axillary nerve enters this region. So how the axillary nerve, in its quest to reach the deltoid muscle, how it's getting there. Also, very closely related will be the posterior circumflex humeral artery. This nerve and artery travel very closely together. The space is bounded by the teres minor superiorly, so right here, the teres major inferiorly. So those are going to be those two teres muscles there. Medially, it will be bounded by the long head of the triceps brachii muscle, which is located on the posterior arm, more to come on the triceps soon. And lastly, medially, it will be bounded by the actual humerus, so the shaft of the humerus. Again, this area is important in allowing identification of where that axillary nerve, as well as its closely traveling artery, will actually enter into this region, and it will innervate that important abductor of the arm, the deltoid. Excellent, we have reached the summary slide. Please take time to review, and I hope this particular slide helps in your studying. Thanks again for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.